You probably remember that the two hypotheses on differences and relationships depend on the content of your assumption and on the scale level of your variables. Do you have an idea what hypothesis we need to formulate to verify the improvement in any Six Sigma project? The standard hypothesis for the control phase is there is a or no difference in taste between the states of X before versus X after. And we will test this hypothesis first for the rating of taste with a t-test to differentiate between the two nominally scaled states. Now that you can read these results, you will recognize that this two-sample t-test for independent samples leads to the same result as the included t-test of the capability analysis. The new cookies taste 0.81 grades better than the old ones, and this result is statistically significant. Thus, we can reject the H0 and adopt the HA. Our improvement is statistically confirmed, and we are convinced that the size of the difference also has a practical benefit for our customers and thus for our bakery. With the next t-test, we want to again evaluate the degree how good the target 1.5 for the chocolate cookies was achieved. And we formulate the corresponding hypothesis. There is a or no difference in taste between the rating and the target. Here we use the one-sample t-test because we compare a sample with a criterion value. And, contrary to the above hypothesis, where we wanted to find a significant difference between before and after, we here wish that the H0 is confirmed, as in the test for normal distribution, because that would mean that the target value is within the confidence interval of the sample, meaning that there is no difference between the data and the target value. But the result is again significant. The mean of the taste ratings is 1.65, and its confidence interval ranges from 1.57 to 1.73. The target value, 1.5, is not included, and thus there is a significant difference between the taste ratings and the target. Although we improved the taste of our cookies, we did not reach our target, and we don't know what caused it yet. I will mention this in the final presentation of my project and will neither justify nor make excuses for it. For although we have not achieved our target, we can demonstrate concrete benefits from our improvements. Hopefully you also got nice results in your project. Now it is about deriving the financial and other benefits and presenting the overall result plausibly. There is no standard procedure for this, but I would like to give you a few clues. The starting points for the results overview are the defined problems, the underlying root causes we have detected, and the associated measures that we have implemented. For cardinally scaled data, we use the t-test or analysis of variance to verify the improvement. Here we can translate the mean difference of significant results into financial benefits. So we might ask ourselves how much the difference has a financial impact. The mean value will represent our expected benefit. But no serious belt will be satisfied with a point estimate. We can additionally use the lower value of the confidence interval to give an estimation of the worst case and the upper value of the confidence interval for an estimation of the best case. Based on these confidence limits, we could, for example, now calculate how much more cookies we can sell in the worst and the best case in the future and derive the profit from this. Furthermore, we can transform cardinally scaled data down to nominal scale level, or we can use originally nominal scaled data to detect changes in the defect rate and evaluate them in monetary terms. The basis for this could be the reduced percentage of defective cookies outside the specification. And the two-sample percentage defective test offers the statistical verification of our defect reduction. And then you can again use the upper and lower limits of the confidence interval to estimate the best and worst case. To illustrate the results for more than one problem, you can use a Pareto chart to show the reduced quality costs for the defined problems and compare them with a Pareto chart of the original quality costs. We therefore expect that the overall reduction in quality costs will be higher than previously estimated in the solutions section. You may need the help of your financial controller to calculate and confirm the financial benefit. Of course, it can happen that your statistically tested results are doubted. for example with the indication of a possibly wrong sampling or a measuring error. Here you can refer to your data collection plan and to the measurement system analysis if you have performed one. The argument of a possibly too small sample size can of course be countered by the fact that your tests have led to a significant result for exactly this sample size. But if you consult the financial controller before the calculation, then the later acceptance by the controller and by your sponsor will increase. In deriving the other non-financial benefits, you may be able to mention the standard methods that have been introduced, which are likely to lead to better, homogeneous, and stable process performance in the long term. This way, you can fill the table with all your solved quality, availability, and consumption problems. You may have been able to implement quick wins already during the project. This is your achievement, and therefore these quick wins should also be listed in this table. Always make sure that you fairly appreciate the contributions of all those involved in the project, so that no one envies and relativizes your success.